First of all, my name is Ryan Rutley, and I'm the owner, the chief executive officer of Psalms Group. And Psalms Group comprises of six activities, which happen to be music production, taxes, creative arts and film, street ministry and missionary work, painting, and Christian modeling. And that's what I do. Man, I had the great opportunity to go to Africa. I was in the city of Yaounde, in Cameroon, which happens to be the second largest city in the whole country, in Yaounde, which is next to Douala. Douala is the largest city. My purpose for going to Cameroon was for missionary work. I produced the album back in 2009 for a good friend of mine named Salvador and the Anointed Ones. Shout out to Salvador. And his album was accomplished. He was connected to some well-known authors and writers and pastors, missionary workers, who invited him. He, in turn, invited me. And so we were connected, and I got a call from Pastor Robinson, who is a phenomenal pastor in Maryland. And when we talked, the Holy Spirit connected us. And that's what I love about God, is we have brothers and sisters all over the world who believe in God. I was connected to him. He was connected to me. We was on the phone. We were praying. We were talking prophetically. Next thing you know, he calls me and says, listen, I want you to go on this trip with us. It's ordained by God. You have to go. Yes. Listen to that. You have to go. I didn't know nothing about Yaounde. I didn't know anything about Cameroon. But it was unction in the Holy Spirit through this man of God that I should go to Africa. After a while, I was unctioned. I was urgently requested to send in my passport so I can get it approved and get a visa. And that happened by way of the Holy Spirit within a few days. Yeah. It normally takes months to get visa. Wow. Within a few days, I was visa'd and I was allowed to go on a trip to Africa. What was my experience like on the airplane and the flight? Well, it's funny because totally the trip was scheduled for 21 hours. Well, it's only 24 hours in a day. So what we did was I had to fly from Detroit, Michigan to Washington, D.C. I was there to meet with the missionaries, the pastors. And then we flew from Washington, D.C. to Turkey. So that was about a 9.5, 10-hour flight. And then we landed there in Istanbul. We landed from Turkey, which is in London. We flew from London to Cameroon, which was another about 9.5, 10-hour flight. Actually that was scheduled for like 11 hours. So that would have made up to 21 hours. So a couple of times we flew out maybe a little early because everybody was on the flight and things like that. On my way, as I'm thinking, you know, I've never been to Africa before. I've never been to London before. So I was wondering, what would I see when I got there? What would it be like with, you know, if I got there and I'm dressed different from them? Right. What would it be like? I'm from Michigan. I had a coat on. They in Africa. You know, all of my questions were answered. When we landed in Africa, yes, I had my jacket on because I came from Washington. I came from Michigan. And this is, mind you, is in March. I took that jacket off so fast, okay? It was very warm in Africa. My thoughts as far as dress, they actually have a lot of class in Africa. It's such a mixture and a variety when it comes to dress because they wear skinny jeans. They wear a lot of jewelry. Their haircuts are kind of like ours now. I think what you see in Africa, what's funny is that you see a lot of originality as far as, like this shirt. This was a gift during the service. They have the African attire and they wear it heavily. It's like a big tradition. What's amazing is you see a lot of things they do. They try to emulate those things that are of the American culture. So, you know, they listen to Jay-Z. They listen to Beyonce, Michael Jackson, and Kirk Franklin. You know, they listen to, I mean, the average radio station like it is over in America is just the way it is over there in Africa. And I thought that was amazing. They try to emulate a lot of things in America. And I thought that was cool. So the answers to my questions and my thoughts on my way to Africa as I'm flying. Of course, there was a lot of times I couldn't sleep because I was excited. Like, wow, my first time there. What am I going to experience? I don't want to be driving in a car and I pull up next to a tiger. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? I don't want to be at a restaurant eating my food and there's an elephant standing at the door while I'm paying my bill, you know. But none of those things were so. It's very common to see snakes. It's very common to see geckos and lizards. I'm sorry to that gecko. I killed a gecko when I first got there. I'm going to take this time to repent. A gecko. Thank you. I killed a gecko when I was there, y'all. It's like I killed him, man. You know. And he was crawling on the wall. I was getting ready to take a shower, and it was crawling on the wall. And I said, "Oh no!" I took my shoe. Bam! 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 So somebody saw the gecko's tail waving, you know, because, you know, it was laying there like about to die, getting ready to quote his will, you know what I'm saying? And so it's like when they saw it, it's like, what happened to this gecko? I said, oh, I killed it, you know. I killed a gecko, you know what I'm saying? And it's like geckos are like ants over here in the United States of America. So I felt bad because they were like, they don't bother people. They don't do anything. They crawl on walls. They crawl on, you know, in the ground and wherever. So I felt bad. So I just want to take this opportunity to repent to Africa for killing my first gecko, y'all. You know, I just want to say I'm sorry.
Psalms Group salutes CEO and founder Ryan D. Rutley for the nominations for the 2015 Rhythm of Gospel Awards. Be sure to click on the descriptions link below therhythmofgospelawards.com and vote for Ryan Rutley debut album Reflections in categories 2 and 9. Also vote for Comedian of the Year Vincent Rutley in category 44.
We were over there for 12 days, and we had some days to rest. We had some days to, you know, to recreate and to go and to sightsee. But my main focus were the 6 days we were there for the convention. The convention was hosted by a fellowship of churches, which is called Christian Missionary Fellowship of Churches International. Hundreds of churches all over the world that come together to worship God, and the host church was there in Cameroon. Wow. With Pastor Joseph, and all these churches come together. It was expected of 15,000 crazy for God Africans during this convention. This was the second annual convention. The first I didn't even know of, but this was the second convention. My original purpose was to go and simply just play the keyboard for Salvador. When I got there, we were in worship. We were worshiping God so intense that when they introduced each church on the first day of orientation, all the churches were introduced, all the missionaries were introduced. So they introduced me as one of the guests, and they discovered that I was a music producer, that I was a worship leader, that I do workshops. And so when they introduced each nation was represented for praise and worship, so they had to sing a song. I had to represent the United States of America. And by representing the United States of America, the song that was impressed in my spirit was, I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. As I sung that song, everybody in Cameroon knew the song and they sang with us. Wow. That was the first day. The second day I showed up, one of my friends and my brothers, he came to me off the stage. They were in worship. They were in praise and worship, and I don't think one of the speakers was there. Brother Ryan, Brother Ryan, Brother Ryan, we need you to come to this stage right now. Right now, come to this stage. Come to this stage. I was there in worship. I'm worshiping God. Brother Ryan, come to this stage now. We need you to lead praise and worship tonight. On the spot, man. We need you to lead praise and worship. And I'm like tonight? There's thousands of people here, man. What, you know? Mind you, remember, probably 3 weeks before even going on this trip, the pastor called me on my phone and said, you have to be there. So as I'm standing there, I said, okay, Lord, I need to hear from you. And the original person that was supposed to lead worship wasn't there. And so in front of all of these people, I'm standing there. The band was on the stage. I get on the stage and I say, okay, Lord, I need you to sing. I need you to minister to us. The band begins to play the music and the Holy Spirit stopped. I told the band to stop playing. Out of nowhere, I'm standing on the stage and I just start smelling rain in the spirit. Out of nowhere, the spirit of worship was high and I kept smelling rain. Like this after rain, a heavy rain, to where like it was just a heavy smell, like that cloud was hanging over us. So as I'm standing on the stage earlier in worship, before we start singing, I was ministering to these flags because there was probably over 20 nations. So I'm speaking prophetically to all the flags, and as I continue to smell rain, my mouth opened up and we started singing, open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. And as I'm singing, I keep smelling heavy rain, heavy rain, heavy rain. As we were in worship, the Holy Spirit began to show me that he wanted to pour down and do something special this evening. And as we're singing, open the floodgates of heaven, the power of God falls like never before. And this woman, she's on the video, is laid out cold. Now, what happened was, God said, tell everybody as the music stopped, and the music continued to play, we're worshiping God, and God says, as we're worshiping God, move out of the place you're in into a new place. And so everybody moves around in the sanctuary, and God said, now in that new place, dance before the Lord. Begin to just worship him. Prophetically. And so as we began to dance and worship the Lord, this woman out of nowhere lost her composure. She fell out in the service and was cold. Now, I'm just thinking maybe she's just under the power of God and, you know, the Holy Spirit is just dealing with her. As we're worshiping God, for more than an hour. And time was just going. And she's laying there cold, and I see her as we're worshiping God, but it wasn't impressed upon my heart to do anything or to say anything or to pray. It was just a matter of just worship God and just let God do what he's doing there. Well, it wasn't until the next day somebody came to me and we were in the service. And they said, have you heard what happened last night while we were worshiping God? I said, no. And my friend, she said, listen, man, she's going to testify today. But what happened was while we were worshiping God so intense last night, this woman died. In the service, this woman died. I said, what? And so I said, well, I'm going to listen to this testimony. This lady gets up the next day in the service. She grabs the microphone. Pastor Joseph introduces her. And she says, listen, everybody, while we were in worship, I experienced God like never before. What happened was, as we began to worship God, she said, the man of God instructed us to dance before the Lord in this new place of God. And as we danced before the Lord, I fell out and lost my composure. And I was taken to a paradise. And the Lord was there with me. And he began to show me with his angels, he was pouring down uncontrollable water on our worship. To the point where you couldn't see the people in between the water. And everything we were singing, now God gave me probably like 3 songs that night. We were just worshiping God flowing. And everything we were singing, she said, God said. That's why it's so important to hear and be sensitive to the Spirit of Christ. Because everything God said in her paradise is what he was saying to us in the natural. And so I thought that was an amazing experience. That was probably one of the greatest experiences that I've ever had in worship.
Watch this. Écoute ceci. Watch this. Regarde ceci. Watch this. Regarde ceci. I got a big secret to tell you. J'ai un grand secret à te dévoiler. Are you ready for the breakthrough? Es-tu prêt pour ta percée? I'm going to tell you
je vais te dire
the reason why we're dancing.
La raison pour laquelle nous dansons.
The Bible says
la Bible dit
that David saw the Ark of the Covenant. David saw the Ark of the Covenant.
David avait vu l'Arche de l'Alliance.
Coming back to the house of God.
Quand il le ramenait dans la maison de Dieu.
In other words, coming back to Cameroon.
Il revient au Cameroun.
Watch this.
Regarde.
Watch this.
Regarde.
The reason why we dance.
La raison pour laquelle nous dansons.
The Bible says that David danced before the Lord.
La Bible dit David dansa devant le Seigneur.
The Bible says.
La Bible dit
that David began to dance.
Daniel dansa dans la tente au lion.
Not because it was coming back. Watch this.
Regarde.
The reason why David danced.
La raison pour laquelle David dansa
is because he didn't see his problem the same way.
C'est parce qu'il ne voyait pas son problème de la même façon.
When you dance,
quand tu danses,
you don't see your problems the same way.
Tu ne vois pas ton problème de la même façon.
So your problem is watching you.
Ton problème te regarde.
Dance.
Dancing.
Worthy is the Lamb. Hey, hey. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Hey, hey.
Worthy is the Lamb.
I can't hear you.
Worthy is the Lamb.
I can't hear you.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Yeah.
Worthy. What is the Lamb?
What is the Lamb?
Dance on your problem.
What is the Lamb? Dance on your problem.
What is the Lamb? What is the Lamb?
Worthy, worthy, worthy.
What is the Lamb?
What is the Lamb?
Worthy, worthy, worthy. What is the Lamb?
Worthy, worthy,
worthy. What is the Lamb? 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 What is the Lamb?
One, two, three, just clap, clap, clap those hands, man, clap, clap. I see the army.
Wow, what did I gain from being in Africa? I gained so much. One of the things that I've gained was the sense of community. In Yaounde in particular, in the city or in the country of Cameroon, what was amazing is we were so well served. The pastor's wife wasn't sedity, she wasn't stuck up. She wasn't so busy to where she didn't have time to care to us. Every single day, she showed up at our place of residence and fed us. All the men, the young men that were around, they greeted us with hugs and with kisses, double hugs and kisses on each side, and said, my brother, my brother. So I gained the sense of community. I also gained such a spiritual, overwhelming experience. every service averaged, there was two services a day. Every service averaged 4 hours, literally. People walked miles. They could have had a headache, they could have had bad feet, they could have had a long day at work, but they walked miles and they were there worshiping God. The average service, again, averaged 4 hours. So I gained a sensitivity to the Spirit of Christ. They worship God. I felt like I was in a stadium. Over here in the NFL, a stadium is roaring for 2.5-3 hours for people throwing balls, getting hurt, getting flipped, getting thrown on the sideline, getting cussed out. There, they were there listening. They were sensitive to the worship. So I gained a spiritual nutrition. I also gained, they have so much class over there in Africa. I mean, the women that dress there are very graceful. The men that are there are very responsible. They're family oriented. They're hardworking men. And they believe in family structure. I thought that was amazing. You don't see, like it's common over here in the United States of America, you see it's common for a house to be broken up. Maybe mom is there, maybe dad is there, maybe, now we just call it a guardian. But over in Africa, they don't tolerate anything less than family conversation. And I thought that was amazing. That's what I was able to bring back. Oh man, I was able to go over there. While I was in Africa, I do want to say I spent a lot of time thinking about my daughters. And I praise God because out of the 2 weeks that I was there, there was some time, a little time that I was not able to spend with my children. So while I was there, I made sure that I brought back some things that would be good for them. I brought back some coloring books from Africa, biblical coloring books. They had some things that were, some fun little blocks and things like that I was able to buy for them. I was also able to buy a little tablet. It's like a cloth table of scriptures that I bought for my dad. My dad is a bishop here in the United States of America in Pontiac, Michigan. And it was the scripture that says, as for me and my house in Joshua, we will serve the Lord. And so I thought that was great to bring that back for my dad. I was able to bring back some DVDs of the services that we were in worship, to bring back the experience that I shared with them. I was able to bring back actually also the, now we call them dollar bills here in the United States of America. They call them francs. And so I believe $10 in the United States of America is worth, $10, $5 in the United States of America is worth 10,000 francs. And so the francs is really half of the dollar amount in the United States of America. So $20 would be 10,000 francs. $5 would be 10,000 francs, if that makes sense. A dollar over here, I love the dollar menu, by the way. Thank you to the dollar menu created. You know, the dollar menu here, well, $1 here is equivalent, if I'm not mistaken, to like 2,000 francs, I believe. So 2,000 francs would be, you know, like, I believe that's like $2, something like that. And I could be wrong, but it's about the estimate. And they always go about what's your approximate dollar amount. So people are all, that's another thing. People are on the streets always trying to get conversions, you know, of francs to dollars, dollars to francs. So, you know, I thought the currency was a very interesting thing that I learned. And I learned that very fast. I learned that very fast.
Psalms Group salutes CEO and founder Ryan D. Rutley for the nominations for the 2015 Rhythm of Gospel Awards. Be sure to click on the descriptions link below therhythmofgospelawards.com and vote for Ryan Rutley debut album Reflections in categories 2 and 9. Also vote for Comedian of the Year Vincent Rutley in category 44.
That's a great question. The resources in Africa are very limited. I can say that what's amazing is whenever it again, it rained a lot. So a lot of times they cut off the internet or they cut off their TV because they wanted to make sure that the resources were well spent. Wow. And when it rained, if it thunderstormed, especially where we stayed, they cut off the internet right away. One time we were eating dinner and all electricity went off in the whole city. It's ran by the government. And so if they feel like they reached a point where they don't have enough for tomorrow, they'll cut it all off. And I thought that was amazing. Where here, you've got unlimited phone call, unlimited internet, unlimited everything, you know. There, it's ran by the government. And so if they feel like you're going to reach a limit where we're not going to have enough for tomorrow or the next week, they shut everything down. So it was pitch black dark. Wow. And so being able to have free access to everything all the time really was a question mark. As far as the economy, they have a shortage when it comes to water. There's a limit when it comes to water. That affects flushing the toilet, that affects taking showers, that reflects cooking, that reflects a lot of elements in life. And I believe that we've taken advantage of the blessing of having fresh water. That's why you always see now you can pledge, you can donate, but the biggest gift is water to them. And so that was one of the things I learned while we were there. The homes in Africa was amazing. It's funny because in Africa, especially in Cameroon, keep in mind, Cameroon is the second largest city in the entire country. And so, with that being said, everything they do is from scratch. They basically are like a debt-free society. They build their own houses. They build their own houses. They do it all. And after they build it, they live in it, you know, and they really put all their energy to other things. And they bring in their friends, their family members, and from scratch, they're digging, they're putting cement up, and they've gotten very crafty. They've gotten very creative when it comes to putting even the windows to the doors up. They don't even use measuring sticks. They don't use that stuff. They use, everything is done with wood. When they measure everything out, they measure it with the wood. And I think that's amazing. So they become very creative in regards to building their homes. The homes are beautiful. The structures are amazing because they've gotten so creative with using the wood, with using the cement, using rocks. And I mean, they've gotten very, 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 very creative. So I thought that was amazing. The lifestyle in Cameroon is amazing because it's a very casual country. Very, very, very casual. It's really hard to get to them if you're trying to reach them with God because they have their mind made up a lot. And, you know, for them to win their souls to Christ, they have to see it evident. They have to see it evident. They have to see examples in front of them. They have to see it constantly. They don't have a long attention span. I mean, of course, nobody has one, but especially in this society. But for them, they can get rude if you get in their way. So you have to have a witness with you. You have to have somebody that's going to really be influential with them. Those are some great things that I learned. Sightseeing was the last thing on my agenda because I was there for two reasons. One, I was there for the missionary work that I was called to do there. And number two, I was there for business. With Psalms Group, I just landed independent distribution. And I thank God I was able to land the relationships that I needed to do that while I was there. With a Christian bookstore and with a church bookstore. And so we were able to do that and land the business there. I was also able to sell CDs and do things while I was there to minister. So I think it came down to the last final days to hours where I was able to sightsee. I was very tired. Being that in Africa, they are 6 hours ahead of us. So my time was limited while I was there. I needed much rest because remember, 8 hours was in service already. So, being able to eat lunch, breakfast, and dinner, I was able to do that while I could. But I was there about my father's business. So I was able to recreate later after a while. But seeing the sun again, I was there about 150 plus miles from the equator, so it was beautiful there. It rained a lot in Africa. The streets are filled with people every day, all day.
Really?
Literally, every day, all day. A school night, it doesn't matter what's going on. Don't have revival because you're going to be tired. Okay? Every day the streets were filled with people. It was like New York. It was an African New York to me because the people were in the streets. They were buying. They were selling. Kids were going to and from school. They might have gone to the marketplace to buy items from their family. It was just so funny because the way they drive there is very serious business over there. it's so funny because you can get hit and they'll keep driving. One time we almost hit a couple people ourselves, and the people hit the car. They hit the car like they was knocking on it, like, get out of the way, you know what I mean? So I thought that was amazing. Over here where we have lines, you know, in the street, you know, we have rules, we got lights. In Cameroon, it ain't happening like that, you know. You get in where you fit in. You can cut somebody off and it's okay, you know. So I thought it was amazing. Culture was very different there. They do believe in sitting down and eating. We got McDonald's, we got Burger King, we got a lot of excuses as to how to eat on the run.
Right.
In Africa, it's not happening like that. They cook every meal. Everything is fresh there. They eat a lot of rice, they eat a lot of vegetables, they grow a lot of things naturally, and I think that's a blessing. That's awesome. That's the thing that I love about that. The women are very family-oriented. They wash the clothes by hand. They hang them by hand. They are with their children in the day. There's no such thing as a daycare over there, and if it is, it's very rare. But the women take care of the household. They're washing the clothes, cooking the meals through the day, attending to the needs of the husband and of the children. I thought that was amazing. So culturally, it's amazing because they give their heart in everything they do. They don't give that responsibility to anybody else.
Right.
And I think that was a remarkable element to experience. Was I able to visit the jungle? If I wanted to visit the jungle, I probably would have driven in a bulletproof car
right.
with four Uzis and protection, you know, like security. No, we weren't in the jungle at all. As a matter of fact, the jungle for us was hundreds of miles north. A preacher, as soon as we got off the plane, we went to a house. And I asked about the jungle. He said, listen, if you go to the jungle, if you go to a yard where the animals are, where the wildlife is, if anybody gets out, drive off. I said, why drive off? I mean, because that person will become a meal, you know? And he said, if they drive off, the animals, there's nowhere for you to hide, there's nowhere for you to go. Now, if you're screaming out of fear, they're going to know that you're fearful, and you will become the meal of the day. But he said the only way the animals won't mess with you, it has to be a lot of people yelling and screaming at the animals with a victorious scream and with a authority behind the scream, and the animals will leave them alone. But if you're yelling out of fear, no fear is going to be in them. They will attack. They will attack. So they said there have been many times where people have been courageous to get out to say, oh, look at the trees and let's go look for a lion and let's go take pictures of the cheetahs. They didn't come back. You know, and so you might have seen a leg or a foot, you know, laying down with a tooth mark in it. You know what I'm saying? So it's no joke there. The wildlife is really the wildlife, you know, there. So it's amazing. As far as restaurants, as far as eating food, they're very creative there. I didn't see one McDonald's, no White Castles, no Burger Kings, no Taco Bells. Everybody ate honestly. Everybody cooked all of the meals. Fast food for them was getting something that was cooked on the streets. Remember, I said everybody's hanging out in the streets. They have very good tender meat. Oh my gosh, they don't play when it comes to the meat. It's very good cooked. They cook the meat fresh. It's very tender, it's very juicy. And you can tell they took their time with it. Rice is a heavy starch there for them. They eat rice like we eat, like we drink water. So as far as the food, we did go to an all-you-can-eat buffet. The food was well cooked. I thought that was amazing. I thought that was amazing how they do everything fresh. Everything is fresh there. What I'd like to talk about is the culture of music in Africa. It's a rich culture because they are very heavy, guitar-driven, rhythmic with the drums, obviously. And they love to dance and celebrate. That's one thing I learned about in Africa. They love to dance and celebrate. Every song to them is a jumping, shouting, screaming, sweating song. And the songs are probably more than 10 minutes. I mean, literally, each song is probably more than 10 minutes. So I thought that was amazing there.
Psalms Group salutes CEO and founder Ryan D. Rutley for the nominations for the 2015 Rhythm of Gospel Awards. Be sure to click on the descriptions link below therhythmofgospelawards.com and vote for Ryan Rutley debut album Reflections in categories 2 and 9. Also vote for Comedian of the Year Vincent Rutley in category 44.
One of the questions that I was always asked was, what was the temperature like?
Do they have ice?
Yeah, do they have ice? It's very recommended that you buy refrigerated water or filtered water and freeze that. But don't use the running water. It's just a common law. Don't use the running water or drink it because that can have an effect on the diseases that are carried there. Malaria is probably the most common disease that's there. And so it's easy for you to get sick there if you're not careful. The questions that I was asked was, you know, things like the water, the temperature, the culture there as far as dress, the beautiful women that are there. You know, you always gonna get guys asking about that. And just what was it like as far as religion? You know, was it tribal? And you see some tribal characteristics that are there. Some of the other questions that I was asked is, what kind of vehicles do they drive? They drive a lot of the, if it's safe to say, a second class citizen versus someone who's very rich or very poor. They drive a lot of older cars that we have here. I mean, some cars I haven't seen in years was common, you know. I haven't seen a Ford Festiva in years, but they driving them, you know what I'm saying? You know, well, nothing to see a car that was, you know, 1998, 1995, 1993. They still driving them jokers, man. I was almost convinced that the cars that we get towed away here, they using them over there. They ship them to Africa and they use them. But there was a lot of people that drove Mercedes-Benz is there. Hummers, Jeeps, a lot of foreign cars too, like Toyota and Acuras and stuff like that. So you saw a lot of that. Definitely, it was amazing there. I thought that it was also amazing there as far as sports. They celebrate soccer like none other. They don't even play football over there. No, actually, there's a huge difference to them. Surprisingly, soccer is soccer there. And football is nowhere in Africa. Nowhere in Africa. So soccer to them is the biggest thing, which soccer is, it's the most viewed sports because the World Cup literally is hands down more viewers watching the World Cup than it is the Super Bowl. And I thought that was amazing. So as far as sports that's celebrated, It's for them, it's only soccer. You don't see baseball, you don't see hockey, you don't see none of that. It's only soccer, and they put their all in soccer. So I thought that was amazing. First question is, what was the view from Africans? What do they think of Americans? Right, about us. They see us as spoiled. They respect us because there's a lot of money, there's a lot of power, there's a lot of wealth, there's a lot of information, there's a lot of technology, there's a lot of resources that the United States have. And so you can't help but to respect that. Is there a little envy? Is there a little strife? Is there a little jealousy maybe there? Maybe. But they view us as, you guys are basically, you wasteful. You're wasteful. That's how they view us. They do respect us because the freedom to worship, the freedom to buy, the freedom to sell, it's apparent that we're known for our freedom. We're very known for our freedom. So they view us as wasteful. Our view of them is they don't have enough. You know, our view of us is, you know, we have it, that's it. What's so amazing is not only Africa, but there are many countries that look at us as if we are wasteful. And to answer the second part question, what was my views approach is, now I have to agree with them, you know, that we're pretty wasteful. And not only wasteful, but we've gotten to the point where we've taken advantage and we've taken for granted how much we dispose. It's nothing. If you don't like a hamburger, you can just throw it away. Where there, they like, wait a minute. Do you know how much work went into making that hamburger? You know what I mean? Do you know how much, you know how many times we had to plant seeds so that the grains could grow, so that we could make the bread, so that you can put that on the meat? Do you know how many animals we had to kill and slice up and take? You know, do you know the tomatoes we had to cut? Do you know we had to grow the pickles? We had to, like, they look at it like that. We just look at it as, I don't like the hamburger, I'm gonna throw it away. You know, so I thought that that with me coming back, I was able to better appreciate what we have. I thank God for hot water. I thank God for being able to, I can drink tap water if I want to. I mean, now we're spoiled. We can go buy water. We can go buy juice. For them, everything is from scratch. Everything they do, they have to work for it. And here in America, we are given, I mean, it's nothing. You can catch a bus now. But in America, people don't want to ride a bus. You know, they don't even have a car. They take a taxi everywhere they go. And what's amazing is it's such cheap labor. When you pay for a taxi, you don't pay for the taxi in Africa just to take you where you want to go. You just pay them to take you wherever you want, and you have that taxi driver for 1 hour. Even if it's for 50 cents, for them it's a lot of money. 50 cents, you have the taxi for 1 hour. So if you say, I just need to go to the cleaners and drop off my suit because I got to bring it back, I got to wear it for class tonight, you have that taxi driver for 1 hour, for 50 cents. And they will sit in front of your house for a whole hour. They won't go anywhere. They turn on the radio, they sit there for the whole, they're dedicated to you for 50 cents for 1 hour. Here, you drive your bus, $2.75, get off, get out, I got somewhere else to go. You know what I mean? So I just think that's amazing. They're very patient there. And while we were there, we had to go to all the services. We had drivers that were with us. But we, in my culture, I wanted to be so mindful of that. I said, we don't need them for an hour. Let them go. Let them pay them and get them out of here. And they were very appreciative of that. So I thought that as far as culturally, that was amazing to me to discover. One of the greatest things that I was able to come back with after going to Africa, from my observation and my perception of Africa before going, versus coming back and saying, hey, this is what I think it is, and then coming back saying, this is really what it is I've learned that one thing that's amazing about God, it doesn't matter what language you talk, it doesn't matter what you say. There are two words that are the same in every culture, and that's hallelujah and Jesus. Wow. I thought that was very amazing. You can blah, 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 Jesus. Whatever you're saying, hallelujah. It's the same thing. And I think that's amazing because Jesus and his impact, the Bible shows us and history declares, scientists have proven that Jesus never traveled more than 200 miles ever outside of his radius, where he worked, where he did performances of miracles, where he preached, yet the entire globe knows who he is. I think that's amazing. I think there's no greater story. While I was there, I talked about one miracle, but there were many miracles that were performed while we were there. We learned so much while we were there. It's the same thing that's happening in Africa is happening in America, where you have false prophets. We learned that there was a prophet while I was there. There was a prophet that had a crusade that was going on, and he had influenced his people to come out to the grass, to sit, to listen to him teach. And when he was done preaching and when he was done teaching, as the altar call, he had the people sit around him, and he began to kick them and hit them and yell at them and scream at them. And he had influenced them in such a way that they sat under his power, under his authority, under his witchcraft. And as he was ministering to them, he closed out by saying, "I now want you all to run out to the grass and eat it." And people uncontrollably, on his count, ran out to the grass, began to just eat the grass as if it was food, uncontrollably. And they were demon-possessed. And I thought that was amazing. And the host pastor taught about that, and I thought that really... it really inspired us to get a personal relationship with God and to become sensitive to the things of God. Not just to take somebody's word for it, but to hear God for yourself, to study his word. Yes, have a pastor, have a leader. But that leader ought to lead you to having a personal relationship, not a personal religionship. Oh man, I feel like preaching right now, y'all. But having a personal relationship with God. In Africa, when you get around people that really love God, you're really going to experience God. The worship services were intense. People got off work, people got out of school, but remember, the services averaged 4 hours. They weren't there saying, "Okay, Pastor, we had praise and worship, we had the announcements, it's time to go home, I got food cooking." They were there for 4 hours sitting, waiting to hear for a word from God. And I thought that was amazing. And so, with that being said, I was able to really appreciate the opportunities that I have when I'm in America to worship God. And not to take that lightly, not to take that for granted, but to enjoy every moment that we spend with God in our worship. If I was to do this trip again, I would do it without thinking twice. If I was to refer this trip to somebody, if I was to encourage young people, pastors, missionaries, to go to Africa, I would encourage them before you die, go. Because you will go and experience God in a way you've never experienced him before. You will be able to not only experience God, but you'll be able to experience natural resources. You will be able to appreciate that if you ain't got enough resources for tomorrow, the government is gonna cut your stuff off. It's not because the bill was late, it's because they don't have enough resources for you today. And, we've got to get to a place where we appreciate what God is doing. We've got to get to a place where we can simply say two words out of a life we live every day that we sometimes look over. And that's all God is looking for is thank you. We've got to become grateful. These folks, water is limited to them. For us, it's nothing to jump in the shower and stay in there 10, 20 minutes, a half an hour, some folks an hour. You know, have the lights on while you sleeping at night. It ain't nobody doing nothing. But for them, they are very careful with using those resources. And so if I was to encourage somebody today, get your passport, get a visa. Do your homework as well. Don't go over there foolishly. You got to know the culture of what you're dealing with over there. I would never recommend, if anybody does any mission trip, I would never recommend you do a mission trip on your own. It's very good to, one, go over there with somebody you know from here, and number two, if you can help it, go over to a land where you do know somebody there. I think that's very important because if you're in unfamiliar territory, then the unfamiliar can happen to you. People have gotten robbed. People have gotten hurt. People have went over and got murdered because they were in unfamiliar territory. That's not to say that that's going to happen, because I believe if you walk with God and if you go over there fasting and praying, that God will protect you. But God will also, fasting and praying, but God would also give you the wisdom to connect with the right people to be protected. And so I think that was the blessing about me going on this mission trip for the very first time, is that I was with people that I were familiar with, and we went to go be with people that they were familiar with. And it would have been hard to go over there not knowing where I was going, not going and going to places that I was not familiar with, because people are money hungry over there. There are some people that's really impoverished there. It's very true. What you see on TV, some of that is true. So people are impoverished. They'll do anything for money. $1 over there to them, they would love. They would love it. I'm told that if you gave somebody $20, they could eat all week in Africa. $20 might get you a sandwich and some fries here in the United States of America, and you might get some water. I mean, you go on a date, $20 is gone in 5 minutes. but in Africa, one thing I was able to appreciate also was the friendship that I gained in Africa. There were many people that greeted me with love, care, and when they found out I was from the United States of America, to them, I was so appreciated and so loved. Where I go in my backyard here, I might be past somebody that I've seen for a long time, I might have known for a long time, and I might get a hi and bye. But for them, they really wanted to engage in the conversation, and that was a blessing. I didn't want to feel like a star. I didn't want to feel like I was the it factor over there. I just wanted to go over there and serve them. I really did. And they served me. Every day I was there, someone gave me a token of love and appreciation for the ministry at hand. I originally was scheduled to go to Africa just to play the keyboard. My thoughts were, I'm going there, Lord, to support this artist I'm going to play. But when I got there, I ended up leading worship every night. And the power of God fell so strong. Lives were changed. I still get text messages, calls, Facebook messages to this day. I just got calls Tuesday of this week. And the beginning of this week, I got messages today on Facebook. I get calls all the time, text messages, Facebook messages of people saying that we did not know that we could give our all in worship. There are parts in Africa where they are reserved, like we are here. And so that the things that I found out in Africa, there are some common things that happen in the United States of America that just happen everywhere. You get jealousy there like you do here. You get envy like you get here. You get gossip there like you get here. So you get competition there like you get here. But one thing that's for sure there is the sense of community. And that's the thing that I was able to gain from it. If I was to ever have like a final thought about Africa, a final, Selah moment to reflect on from Africa, I would say that God reigns everywhere. His passion, his love does not stop in the United States of America. It's in Africa, it's in India. God always leaves a witness everywhere. I'm reminded of a passage of scripture where God said that it's more than just you that's not compromising, that's not bowing to Baal. But I've got many others who's not bowing. And I wanted to encourage the listener, the viewers, that God is everywhere. That's why one of his names is omniscient. He is omnipresent. God is in Africa. God is in India. God is in Japan. God is in Arabia. God is in Afghanistan. One thing that I thought was very funny on the plane, on my way back home, I met a man that's from Afghanistan. And if you understand the time of rumors of wars and wars, this man looked at me on the plane. I sat next to him. And he looked at me and he found out that I was there on a mission trip. And he said, you know, he told me his name, I told him my name, and he looked at me. He said, listen, Ryan, I want to tell you a secret. He said, the wars that were going on between our countries, he said, we're not fighting each other. He said, our government is fighting each other. He said, the people, he said, I'm okay with you. You're okay with me. It's our governments that's fighting. And when he said that, it rang a bell in my spirit, and it reminded me of the scripture. If my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. And I was reminded, it's not the people, it's the principles that we have to understand are in place. If we can honor the principles of God, which is to love thy neighbor as we love ourselves, then we'll understand that the war is not a carnal one, it's really spiritual. And I was able to walk away knowing that even people in Afghanistan who, you know, we look at from the outside in, really, there's nothing to hate about them. There's nothing to hate about anyone, but that they are our brothers and sisters. If they do the will of God's Father, of our Father, then they are our brothers, they are our sisters. And so I was able to give thought, and I'm able to give gratefulness to God. I'm able to give praise to God for the total experience. I'm coming back. I'm going back to Cameroon. I'm going to have fun in Cameroon again. And next time I'm going to bring a crew with me. We're going to minister the good news of Jesus Christ. And we're going to film it. We're going to take you with us. I want to take testimonies. I want to take young people with me. I want to take pastors and bishops. I want to take people who feel like they are the underdog, who feel like they can't do anything, who felt like they weren't qualified. I want to take them. And I want them to walk the streets with us and to see somebody from another culture and be able to minister to them and give them Jesus Christ.